Hi friends, back with another video. In this part of the video, we are going to learn about how to model a bridge and dike structures. So in the last part of the video, we have learned about the modeling of the culvert and the contracted weir. So if you look at this sketch for this bridge and the same sketch in the plan view, it looks like this. If you look into this, there are four cross sections. That is the 1, 2, 3, 4 from downstream to upstream. So between these two cross section, there is cross section number 2 and cross section number 3, I am going to model a bridge. So due to this bridge structure, so which is kind of obstruction to the stream flow, so which results in the contraction and expansion of the flow at upstream and at the downstream. At the upstream, that is contraction, and at the downstream, it is expansion. So we need to define the what is the zone of the contraction and zone of the expansion. So it requires some field observation and requires some field investigation, but however it's difficult to conduct a field investigation at the site. So in that case, we can use some approximate method to find the length of the contraction zone, that is LC, and length of the expansion zone, that is LE. And also we need to obstruct the flow at this expansion zone and the contraction zone. That is, we need to obstruct this obstruct the limit of the flow at this cross section 4, that is the cross section upstream to this cross section 3 bridge cross section, it's the cross section 4, and similarly that is at the downstream, that is the expansion zones. Here also we need to restrict the flow of the expansion. So here you can see this ratio, that is the ER is the expansion ratio and CR is the contraction ratio. So initially we will find what is the length of the contraction zone and length of the expansion zone. So here I have the typical bridge section. So here is the geometry of the bridge section which I am going to model at this location. Here is that bridge location. So here you can see these are the abutments and pier. So width of the each pier is 12 feet. And this is the floodplain width. So floodplain width is based on the site investigation and building some new numerical models to approximate the floodplain width. Here I have taken this approximate floodplain width for 100 year flood. So it comes up to this slightly below the deck of the bridge. So it comes up to here. It is the floodplain width. Okay, and this is the bridge opening. So bridge opening is between the bridge openings between these pier to pier is 35 feet, and for the pier to abutment it is 48 feet. So this we will use this spacing in our calculation to find the contraction and expansion zone. So if you look into this sketch, it will these are the obstructions of the bridge. So if you look at this AB and CD, these are nothing but the obstructions like bridge abutment and the pier. So same are shown here. So same which are shown here. So for the length of the contraction section, so here we have the formula to find the length of the contraction, that is the LC. So length of the contraction is equals to 1 times the average length between the abutment zone. So if you look into this abutment zone, length of the contraction is the average length of the abutment zone. If you look into this bridge here, so this one is the one part of the abutment and this one is the another part of the abutment. So these are two abutments at on the either sides of the bridge. So we need to consider the average value between these two, this abutment, which is a which is the length of the contraction zone. So the average value becomes 100 plus 140 divided by 2. So that is the average value of this abutment. This average length of the abutment, which is act as a length of the contraction section, that is here for this cross section. So that is the cross section, the length of the cross section between 3 and 4. So this is the length of the contraction between 3 and 4. So let's find the value. What is the length of the contraction? Length of the contraction zone, that is one side of the abutment has a width of 140 meter feet and another side is having, one side of the abutment is having 100 feet and another side of the abutment is having 40 feet, and average value of it is 70. Okay, one part of the so that means we have find we have found the value of the length of the contraction zone, that is the length between the 3 and 4. This we found the LC. Now we find the length of the expansion zone, that is LE. So for LE, so what it's the formula from the Heckrass manual says, the average obstruction length between AB and CD. So this one is here, if you look into this, this is the average of average obstruction length. If you divide it into two parts here, into two equal halves, so one part we need to take the average from one half plus another half divided by 2, that is the average between average obstruction length of this bridge. That means we are going to consider average of these two half. So that means if suppose this one is the bridge, the length of the contraction length of the expansion zone becomes AB plus CD divided by 2, that is the average obstruction length. So if we, for the bridge, what would be the obstruction? One is the abutment, which act as a obstruction, and another one is the pier, which act as a obstruction for the flow. So these are the two elements of the bridge which act as a obstruction length. So if you move to this bridge section, so one is the obstruction length. So if I divide this into two halves by keeping this center of the bridge, this is the second pier, which act as a center between which divides this bridge into two halves, that is the one part and another part. Okay, so here one comes the obstruction for the abutment, that is for the one side is it is 100 feet plus this length. The what is the width of the pier, that is 12 feet. So it is acted as another obstruction, and the center of the second pier, the half, that is half of the 12 feet. So half of the 12 feet is 6. So that means 12 plus 6 plus this abutment length, which is 100 feet for one side, and another side it is abutment length 40 plus width of the one pier, that is 12 feet, and half of the second second abutment, that is 6 feet. So we need to consider the obstruction average obstruction from this half and this half. Okay, so let's do that here. Okay, so first, so width of the one pier, one side of the abutment was 100 feet plus the width of the first abutment, that is 12 feet, plus one half of the second abutment. One half of the width of the first pier, that is, here 100 feet is the width of the first abutment, and the width of the first pier, that is 12 feet, and half of the width of the second pier, that is 6.
Now for the other part of the abutment, that is the width of the abutment is 40 feet plus width of the pier, that is pier number 3, it is 12 feet, and the half of the center line, which is reference we taken for the average obstruction, that is half of the pier number half of the pier width, that is 6 feet, and average value, that is divided by 2 between two parts of these obstructions, so that means 88 feet. So we found the value of the length of the contraction section LC, that is 70 feet, and length of the expansion zone LA, that is 88 feet. So that is here, these zones we found the distance between the cross section 4 and 3, that is LC, the contraction zone, which is 70 feet, and the length between the zone 2 and 1, that is LE, the expansion zone, it is 88. So now we will move to HECRAS and mark these locations on and mark this location and create a two new cross section, that is 4, cross section number 4 and cross section number 1. So move to HECRAS. So here you can see I have already marked the location and created a new cross section, that is 3014, that is for contraction zone, and 2813, that is for expansion zone. Here you can see I tentatively marked using this reverse stationing. Here you can, if you open this layer, there is an option called reverse stationing. So once you turn on this reverse stationing option, so you can get the reference from of the chainage of the river chainage. So based on this reference, for I taken this as a reference and marked 70 meter feet on the upstream and 88 feet on the downstream. So these are the two new cross sections, that is cross section number 3014 and 2813. So now move to HECRAS geometry editor and create the bridge geometry. Okay, so now move to HECRAS geometrical editor. So this is a geometry, and move to section 2940. This is upstream of the bridge cross section. So now move to add bridge and culvert. So options, add new bridge or culvert, the stationing name. So where I'm going to model a bridge, the stationing name is here 2936. So this is the upstream cross section of the bridge, and this is the downstream cross section. So initially we will define the roadway deck. So roadway deck data I have here. Roadway deck data, distance from the upstream is 3 feet. 3 feet, width of the bridge deck is 22.5, the square coefficient is 2.6, and for the high chord and low chord, I have already have the stations, and I already explained about what is high chord and low chord in my previous video on culverts. So I just copy these values of the bridgeway deck and paste it here. Okay, this maximum submergence is 0.9. It is related with the which equation which you solve when the submergence exceeds the 0.98%. Okay, all right. So we have defined this bridge deck section. Now move to bridge pier. So center line station of the upstream and downstream, where the downstream and upstream center line stations, if I explain this here, so what is exactly it is. So if you move to this, yes, so if you take this as a stations, so this is the zero station and the station number last station of the bridge deck. Okay, so this is the zero station. So zero station for pier number one, this is a center line. So suppose this station is at some 5449, so this is the center line of the first station. Similarly, you need to just define the center line of the first pier. It is the here, it is 485 for the second pier and 520 for the third pier, and this is the last station. So we need to mark the center line of the pier. Okay, like this we need to define. So for the first station of the, so now for the first pier, so we have the data. Center line of the bridge pier is this one. Upstream center line same. We take same value for upstream and both downstream. Okay. Upstream and downstream has same center line. And apply the floating debris. I don't want to consider any cases of floating debris on the near the bridge pier, so let it be off as it is. For upstream and downstream bridge pier stations, I can directly copy these values. Okay, let's copy it. Paste it here, paste it, copy this value, move to second bridge. In the second bridge, move to second pier. In the second pier, you need to change the station name. So that is 485, it's the station name for both upstream and downstream. Okay, similarly, copy it. Now for the third station, it is 520 for both upstream and downstream center line of the bridge pier. Okay, okay. So three bridge piers are created. Okay, so three bridge piers are created. So if I zoom it here, so in this bridge section, what are the areas which are ineffective? That means which doesn't allow the convey of the flow. So if you consider this bridge section, so this pier and abutment do not allow the conveying the flow from upstream to downstream, so which is act as a obstruction to the flow of stream flow through this bridge. So this act as a permanently ineffective area. So we have to define this abutment and pier as permanently ineffective area to the upstream of this 2936, that is cross section number 2940, and we have to define this bridge and pier cross section as the ineffective area to the flow. So just move to here, just move to edit cross section and move to this ineffective flow area. In ineffective flow area, there are multiple blocks. So I have this data for ineffective, to define this ineffective area for this bridge, that is the pier and abutment. I just copy this data and paste it there. Multiple blocks, ineffective area, multiple blocks, just okay. Okay, these are the ineffective area. So if you look into here,
so we can check out these cross sections. So if you move to cross section, this is the upstream bridge cross section, and this is the upstream downstream bridge cross section, and we have made ineffective areas to the cross section which is upstream to the upstream bridge cross section. So that is 2940. So we have made permanently ineffective, and this looks like this. Okay, all right. So just and if you look into this cross section, bridge cross section, so we need to mark these zones here. So if we need to mark this contraction zone, we need to define the contraction ratio to mark the obstruction for the contraction zone, contraction cross section, and the expansion cross section. We need to define the expansion ratio for this expansion zone, that is ER and ratio CR. So for this ER, it is fixed, it is 1:1. For ER, that is the expansion ratio, so we have some set of formulas we need to solve, some formulas, and we need to check that values in the table. That is the, here is the expansion ratio table. So if you look into this here, how can we solve that? So if you look into this table here, so we can find this expansion and contraction zone. So we need to know the ratio of the overbank mannings and the channel mannings. So I can find this N overbank divided by NC is nothing but N overbank is 0.04 and zero point zero three five divided by zero point zero four. Okay, it is 1.14, which is nearly the first one. The NOB by OC NC is the 1, so we can take it approximately as 1. Okay, that is NB by NOB by NC ratio. Now we need to find the B divided by, we need to find the ratio of B divided by capital B. So it is nothing but, if you go to here, here is that, where B is the width of the floodplain and small b is the width of the bridge opening. So for the width of the bridge opening, so I have here, I have already defined. So one is the distance between the abutment to pier, which act as a opening. So it is 48 feet, 35 feet for the spacing between pier to pier, and again 48 feet. So 48 plus 35, 35 plus 48, this is the bridge opening length, width of the bridge opening, and the width of the floodplain. So width of the floodplain I have already marked here. Here, if you look at, it is nearly 300 feet. That is the floodplain width. Okay, so floodplain width I have already marked. That is 300 feet, and width of the bridge opening is 48 plus 35 plus 45. Okay, so bridge, so ratio between B by B, that is the width of the bridge opening to the width of the floodplain is 0.55. Okay, so it is nearly this one, third one, b by b, which is nearly 0.5. Okay, now we need to find the slope. So for the slopes, here is the slope. The slope is 10 feet per miles. So 10 feet per mile is the slope. Okay, so this is the length and this is the rise in the elevation. Okay, so same if you move to RasMapper. So if I check out this profile, it is like this. So the drop is nearly 5 feet and the chainage is length of the chain slope line is 2440 feet. So 2440 feet and the 5 feet drop in the elevation. So I got the slope as 10 feet per miles. So just refer this 10 feet per mile and this NOB by NC, that is the Manning surface ratio of overbank to the channel. It's nearly 1, which is already computed. And the slope is 10 feet per mile. So here is the approximate contraction expansion ratio, that is 1.322. Say I will take consider this expansion ratio, I will consider as 2. Okay, for the expansion zone, so this is the our limit from 1.2 to 2, but I will consider the expansion ratio as 2 and contraction ratio as 1. So that is already defined in the here. Okay, it is already defined. Okay, so now move to this cross sections. So approximate bridge opening for this cross section comes at, we need to mark this abutment at what station the abutments are located here. So for this bridge, so one side of the abutment is located at 560 and another side of the abutment is located at station 400. It is approximate. I need to mark these two locations of the abutment on the stations. So it's the 400 and 550. Okay, 400 and 550. So I will move to here. I will move to this bridge cross sections structures. So this is the, okay, I need to mark the river cross section stations. Okay, okay, so cross sections are at 400 and 550. It is approximate, nearly, yes, I can say 550 or 560 to 70. I will consider 560 here and 400. I need to mark that location on the banks. Okay, at one side it is 400. From 400, I'll just mark a tentative line for the reference. A 400 line here. Okay, 400 line. You need to draw a perpendicular line
I'll just adjust it, it's not much perpendicular. Okay, and another side, it is 550. 550. 550 comes somewhere here. Just mark the 550 here for the contraction side, and same for the expansion side. 550. Draw a perpendicular line, 550 and 400. Just draw a perpendicular line, almost perpendicular. But for this task, I would recommend to use Civil 3D to make it easy. In RasMapper, it takes it takes much more time, and these works are not much accurate compared to Civil 3D. So here I have marked the location. It's a tentatively line, and for the contraction zone, the ratio of the CR is 1. That is 1:1. So 1:1 means this line, this horizontal component of the line is same as the length of the LC, 1:1. So we will mark that here, 1:1. From the here, the length of the contraction zone. So length of the contraction zone was 70 feet. Okay, so mark this 70 feet here. 70 feet. So this station is at 385. From 385, minus 70, it is 315. It comes somewhere here. 315. Okay. Same on the other side. It is at 535. 535 plus 70, 605. Okay. 605. Okay, so one side it is, we have done that. We'll name this as bridge station marking. Okay, and I will change its colors to make it okay. So that means this is the obstruction length. So from 600 till the end of the overbank is the obstructions, and on this side, and similarly obstruction on the other side is from the 315 till the end of the cross section. So this will define we will define this as the ineffective area. Okay. So same for the other side. So for the same for the expansion zone, for the expansion zone, So we need to mark ineffective areas. So if you look into this expansion zone, the ratio is, I have taken the ratio as 2. So I have taken the ratio as 2. So I will move to here. Okay. 2. That means 2 times the 88. For the bridge, for the expansion zone, it is 2 times the 88. Okay. So here is the station, the bridge, the cross section station number is 400. 400. Minus 2 into 88. It is 224 for one side. So this is the expansion. 224 comes somewhere here. Same on the other side. So it is at station 560. 560 plus 2 into 88 up to 736. I need to mark. It comes somewhere here. Okay, so we have marked the location of the expansion and contraction zone. Okay, so now we move to this cross section number 3014 and make it this 315 at one side to be ineffective area and nearly how much it is 605 on the other as ineffective area. So now move to here, move to here in the bridge geometry. Okay, 3014. I can do it this task easily by moving, going here, this graphical cross section editor. Okay, I move to this graphical cross section editor and station name is 315 and 605 or the contraction zone 305. Is come somewhere here. And 315 and 605. So it's just a rough which I have marked. So for one station, that is 3014, I have done, and for next station, that is 2810, that is the contraction zone. Sorry, that is for expansion zone. There is 224 on one side and 736 on the other side. Is 224. On one side 224 on one side and 736 on the other side. It comes approximately at this location. Okay, so this is for the expansion zone. Okay, do it once again. Seven, 736 and 224. Okay. Okay, so we have defined this for these two cross sections. So now we can check that here. So here is this for one cross section, another cross section. So we have defined the ineffective areas here. Okay. Here we have to define for 2810, we have defined only for one side. If I move to this. Here is set another. Okay, we have already defined. Okay. Okay, so save this geometry. Okay, so next is the bridge deck area. So bridge deck area I have already defined. So that this dike lines here you can see. If you move to this cross section, here I already defined this. So here is the die cross section. You can add this die cross section from options, levies, so which act as a dike. So you need to define this left levy bank levy and its corresponding elevations, because I am taking the left bank because it is at lower elevation and this area is going to submerge if you don't provide the dikes or a levy. So that's why I am considering only for the left bank. Okay, these are the cross section, so I considered levy on the left bank. Okay, so this is the levy. So this is the levy. Okay. Okay. Full plot. Save geometry. So now. Here I will once again add the dike. So how can we add the dike? Just you can move to this table, levies. So in the levies I have this it asks for left bank station and its corresponding levy elevation for the left bank, right bank station and corresponding elevation for the right bank. So here I directly have this data. This is the reverse bank stations and it's a left bank station and corresponding dike elevation for the left bank stations. Okay, so I will directly copy this value. Just copy this one and 2652, so it is here 21428. Just copy it, its values. So I have copied and pasted this left station levy and its elevation. So okay, so here you can see this if you move to cross section, you can see the dikes, that is nothing but levies, are defined. The another option is you can add that from here. Is you need to enter your the left bank station and its corresponding levy height. So you can add same for the right bank station and its corresponding levy height. Okay, all right. So I have marked the dikes now. Now move to the boundary conditions to add the study flow boundary conditions. This is the 25 air flow. Now move to reach boundary condition. Here is the one change due to this contracted wear, that is drop structure, that's a drop structures on the upstream. So the energy is specific energy at the drop structure is at minimum. That means it's at critical depth. It corresponds to critical depth. So I will assign the upstream as critical depth boundary condition. Okay. Apply the data and save the steady flow data. Okay, we have saved it. And before that, there is a one more thing which I need to add. So for the bridge. So for the bridge, for this one is the contraction zone. So I will move to this edit, and here I want to change the contraction coefficient. So since it's a contraction zone, and it's I need to change this boundary conditions. So based on the ACRAS manual, so what it says? Yes. For the typical bridge section for the contraction zone, it is 0.3. So it is 0.3. Okay, it is actually the upstream cross section of the bridge. That is the first cross section number 1 in the contraction zone. Okay. Apply the data for the contraction, and second is the bridge zone, that is 29 upstream of the bridge. So here I need to add both contraction and expansion coefficient. So for contraction and expansion coefficient for the bridge is 0.3 and 0.5. 0.3 and 0.5. Okay, I have already added it 0.3 and 0.5. Next one comes the expansion zone. That is the final cross section of the expansion, that is the cross section number 4 in that sketch which I have shown in this initially, which I have shown in the sketch where I shown the what is the expansion zone, the contraction zone. So for this expansion zone, the 2813, the expansion zone, the coefficient is 0.5. okay, just add this here, 0.5. apply the data. Okay, so we have applied the data. Okay, all data are applied. Just save your geometry. Save geometry. Now, time to run the model. Study flow analysis. I am running the model in the mixed flow condition. Okay, compute. All right. So model is run successfully. Save the plan. So here is the profile view of the longitudinal profile of this section. So this one is the contracted wear, this one is the bridge section, and this one is the levee station, or you can call it as a dike station line. These are the elevations, and this one is the culvert. Okay, which is modeled in the last video, that is the culvert at the downstream. If you check that in the perspective view, it looks like this. This is the perspective view, that is the upstream contracted wear, intermediate bridge, and at the downstream culvert, and you can see the series of the dikes at the bank of the river. So you can see these are the dikes. This yellow color lines which indicates the dikes, dike stations. Okay. Alright. We'll float now. We move to RasMapper. So RasMapper can so on the upstream you can see the head of the water is more sudden rise of the water is due to wear. You can see the head of this water on the upstream is slightly higher because due to the construction of the wear, due to modeling of the wear. So the at the upstream the head of the water is more. This one is the bridge section, and the culvert comes here. If I show you here, the culvert comes at the downstream. This one is the culvert section where I have modeled a culvert. Okay. All right. So thank you for watching. In the next part of the video, I will make a video. I will run the same model in the unsteady flow, unsteady flow condition, and I will try to stabilize it. If it goes, model goes unstable, I will do some trial and error method. If it goes unstable, I will try to stabilize it. Okay, thank you for watching.